Yeah. This panel is
lots of them.
This panel is about the author, writer, translator, and literary critic from Germany, based in Cologne, Stephen Weidner. Stephen Weidner has a wide and broad background. Has studied Arabic and Islamic studies at Göttingen, at Damascus, at University of California, Berkeley, at the University of Bonn. Is a major writer, as I said, and translator from Arabic. Has translated the work of the Syrian, one of the greatest living Arab poet in Arabic, we call him Adonis, in English Adonis. His name is Ali Ahmed Said, and also the famous national poet of Palestine, Mahmoud Darwish, and amongst others. And he has also done a major translation of Ibn Arabi's long work. Is recipient of many awards, a person who is known worldwide, has taught at the Free University in Berlin, is a visiting professor at the University of Bonn. His most recent book, and maybe there are others, but this is what I found, is Beyond the Conception of the West for a New Cosmopolitan Thinking. And like I said, we are very grateful that he's here. Our very own Goethe Institute has been very kind to sponsor this visit. He's going to go to Lahore, which I hope I see you there again. We have just met a few days ago over the internet, and to be honest, I have just started, in a very superficial way, started to read his work and have been really impressed, and I will continue to have this engagement. So. The title of our panel is Islamophobia and the West, but we want to start the conversation on a much more broad level, and we'll get to it. We'll get to the issue of the other in Europe today, or in the West today, or the other within us, and the way of how should we combat xenophobia, hatred, how should we spread tolerance, how should we accept diversity? Those are the larger questions that are not particular to Europe, but to all of us. But before that, I'll start at speaking to, if I may say, Stefan. And I said that perhaps one of the things that he talks about in his work, the little that I've read, is the notion of the stranger, which is a notion that is present in a lot of work in most literary traditions. Stefan's work has been in the Arabic tradition, and what we in Urdu or in South Asian language assume to be the poor, gharib, in Arabic, of course, gharib is the stranger. And over here we say ajnabi, but you know, gharibul watan is not the poor of this nation, but it is the stranger, right? So I think I'll start, because we are going to go to the other. I think this would be a good place, because he has had very thoughtful articulations of the notion of gharib in the Arabic tradition, at least, or the Middle Eastern tradition, at least. So I'll that's the first sort of intervention I'd like from you, to really expand on that briefly, and then we'll go to other things.
Yeah. Thank you, Kamra. Thank you for coming here. Thanks for this generous invitation to this beautiful place. It's really a garden of literature, which is something fantastic, and the famous Farsi poet Saadi would have been proud. He wrote a book called The Gulistan, The Garden of Roses, and this is a garden of books. So thanks for having me here. Thanks, Kamra, for this very nice introduction. Yes, let's start immediately with this idea of the stranger. And I was just about to ask you what the gharib, the word stranger in Arabic, what is the equivalent in Urdu and other South Asian languages? And you just answered it before I could even ask it, which is very nice. And I can now tell you why it means in your language is poor, while it originally means strange. I can tell you that, and I'm going to tell you that. But to start with, I'm going to start with a hadith, with a tradition of the Prophet, of Prophet Muhammad. Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Bada'a al-Islamu ghariban wa sayaudu kama bada'a ghariban fatuba lil ghuraba. That means approximately Islam began as a stranger or as something strange, and it will become again like a stranger. Therefore, blessed are the strangers. So the Prophet blesses the strangers. He was very much in favor of the strangers, and he knew what it means to be a stranger. Why did he knew it? Of course, if you know early Muslim history, you know the Muslims had to emigrate from Mecca to Medina. This was the famous Hijra. They emigrated because they were persecuted in Mecca, and they had to go away. And therefore, there were two kinds of being a stranger for the early Islam. First of all, they were strangers in their own homeland, in Mecca, because they had a different belief, okay? And because they felt like a stranger, that they were treated like a stranger, they had to immigrate to Medina. And in Medina, of course, that was not their hometown. So again, they were strangers. And this is why the Prophet could say that the Islam, bada'a ghariban, he started like a stranger. Of course, we don't know what he meant when he said it will end as a stranger, because the end has not yet come, fortunately. So let's wait for that. But we know for sure that he blesses the strangers, you know. And there's another very famous hadith, which says in Arabic, "Kun fi dunya ka'annaka gharibun aw abiru sabilin." Be. In translation, it's be in this world, which means this world here, you know. Be in this world like a stranger or somebody who passes by in an alleyway or in somebody in a road, you know. So the Prophet even recommends us to be strangers, you know, which is also a very for now, for modern ears, for our ears, we always try to find a homeland, to build a home, to buy a house, to establish ourselves, to feel at home, you know. And the Prophet says, no. Try to be like a stranger, you know, or somebody who just walks by on the road, you know. So this was a conception which. Of course, there are many other conceptions in Islam, but this was a mainstream conception for Muslims in the medieval age for a long time, especially for true believers, and more especially so for the Sufis, for the Dervish, for the Islamic mystics, you know. They adopted this saying by the Prophet, and they strove for being a stranger in this world. You know why? Because, of course, what is the idea behind this conception? The idea behind is that your true home is not here. It's not in this world. Your true home is in the afterworld. It's with God, you know? So you're like an, every man is like an exilee on earth, because his true home is with God, you know? And this is why you should always remember that you, in truth, you're a stranger. And if you're a true believer, you know this, and you strive for God, and this is why feeling like a stranger is something religious, you know, something good, you know? And those people who were very religious, they tried to make a lifestyle out of it. They made a lifestyle out of it, and those were the Sufis, the Muslim mystics. And I can quote you just a few sayings by the mystics, and I quote it in English now. For example, a Sufi saying says, "A stranger is he who is far from home while he dwells there." So even if you are literally at home, because you live, for example, in Karachi, you know, but at the same time you feel strange because you're not satisfied with your situation, because something is odd. You are at odds with the world, you know, and then you are like a stranger at home, you know. And this is the Sufi conception. Is very important that you feel even strange when you are at home, yeah. Or they say, for example, the mystic Shibli, a famous one, in the 10th century, He said, a stranger is not he who is far from his homeland, but who has few siblings and people like himself. So if you have few friends, even if you are, when you are at home, you might feel like a stranger. Or he said, your feeling of being strange towards yourself, your soul and the whole creation makes you, turns you into a stranger, you know? So from a modern perspective, this is a psychological stance, and you might be recommended by your doctor to go to a psychologist, you know, to get rid of this idea, you know. But the Sufis say, well, it's good because then you remember God, you know. So the funny thing is, why am I interested in this? And this is in the larger context of my thinking about what is cosmopolitanism, or how can we get an understanding, or how can we find a narrative or a worldview which comprises everybody, where there's a space for everybody, you know? And then I find this saying of the prophet about the strangers, and I think it's very beautiful and very strong. You know why? Because you can say that in modernity, with modern times, you know, everybody is a stranger, you know, because when you're living in a city like Karachi, or I live in Berlin or in Cologne, you always, the most people you see every day are strangers to you. You don't know them, you know. And also the developments are so fast, you know, everything changes so fast that you, that it's very easy not to feel at home, you know. And you might feel as a stranger, you know. And so this is something everybody understands. Everybody in the world now understands, you know. And the saying of the prophet says that in truth, we are strange. Every human being is a stranger, because his real home is in the afterworld. At least if he is a believer. But if he's a non-believer, what then? Well, I can tell you, because there's a Western philosophical tradition, you know. You can call it existentialism, you know, which made a big for existentialism like Sartre, and maybe mainly Albert Camus, the French existentialism. They said that man is strange in the world anyways, you know, he's a big stranger. The famous novel by Albert Camus is L'étranger, the stranger, you know, and he made a philosophical concept out of that. And so the idea that man is a stranger in the world in modernity has also become a Western idea, you know. So even if you are a non-believer, you can connect to this idea, because it's a very strong philosophical stance, you know. And so you have a common denominator, you know. We can all refer to this idea of being a stranger in the world, if you are believers or non-believers. And that is something very beautiful. Why? Because if we are all strangers, then there is no difference anymore between strangers and people at home, between foreigners and strangers. So if you migrate to another country, you know, and you have this idea in mind, you know, everybody is a stranger anyway, so there is no difference, you know. And that means that every human being can be solidaric, you know. There's a solidarity of strangers, you know. If everybody is a stranger in a way, nobody is a stranger anymore, because you share this destiny of being a stranger, you know? So this is a very beautiful concept, especially in a time when there's a lot of migration, when there's a lot of international conflict, and when everybody strives to get their own identity, their own homeland, to establish themselves. But in truth, all this trying to establish oneself is also separating one from the other, be it the neighbor, be it the other nation, be it the other religion, be it the other ideology whatsoever. And this is what I find so beautiful about this concept. And as I told you, it's quite easy to connect it with Western traditions. This is what I try at present to do.
Thank you, and that's very enlightening. And so one of the things that, again, taking this a bit forward, is the notion of cosmopolitanism, or a lot of strangers trying to communicate with each other. And to communicate, we need languages. Again, there are certain kinds of languages that have deeper roots and others that don't, or even a multicultural or a multilingual community. And what you have worked is that the notion of interpretation and translation. So, and then if I may quote another of your and Stefan's fellow country person or countryman, Benjamin's work, right? I mean, he talks about translation and talks about the task of translation is not to make Greek or Hindi or English into German, but to really penetrate the cultural meaning so that, and it's kind of a, for lack, I mean, I give myself away, it's kind of a very sort of a culturally situated kind of notion of translation, where, so for if we can say pain or brot or bread, they mean bread or roti, but the point is they don't have the same cultural significance in each culture. So those kinds of ways, and what you are also talking about in terms of communication and translation is that we have given up. We want to just read everything if we have an ability to. Like for instance, you want to read, you would read Goethe in German, but you would read Shakespeare in English because you can. But what if we don't read Shakespeare in English, but try to understand it through a certain kind of an interpretive mode? And that's the way that strangers will have to, rather than sort of bring everything down to some common language, try to retain the diversity of the linguistic field. I'm trying to be smart as you are after reading you, but you
try to be smarter. You try to be as smart as Benjamin.
Well, I've heard in Germany.
I'm afraid you succeed. If you continue, you will succeed.
Well, Benjamin is more popular across the Atlantic than in Germany. That I do know. But what I'm trying to say is that that's your kind of the kind of work that you've done is precisely to really address not only the issue of a stranger, but the issue of communication and make it much more democratic. So a very different kind of cosmopolitanism where everyone is not speaking in the same mode, but rather really retaining the diversity of strangeness. And if you could say, if I'm interpreting it correctly.
Yeah, that's fine. Of course, translation is a very, very complex issue. Just to come back, because I now realize, while you talk about translation, I realize, well, I promise you to tell you why the gharib has become the poor in your languages. But this is, of course, because of the Sufis, you know? As I told you, the Sufis adopted this idea of being strange, of idea of being gharib, you know? And the Sufis, they tried to be very poor, you know? They were the dervish, you know? They were the fakir, the fukara. And they tried to be poor. And this is why it came from the Sufis, you know? The Sufis turned the term gharib into the term poor, you know? So now I've translated this riddle in a way, you know? And yes, translation is a very, very tricky issue because first of all, there is no, you will never have an absolute equivalence, you know? So that means that every translation is in a way a distortion or is a development or is another step in the history of a certain text, you know? And we have to take this into consideration because if we strive to give an equivalence, that will not work, you know? So this is why, justly so, they say the Quran is untranslatable, you know? But this is not only true for the Quran. This is true for any real text, any text which is more than just a description of how to use your washing machine, you know? This is very difficult. We have to make, as a translator, you have to make many decisions, like what you said, you know? Do I translate the roti as bread, or do I leave it as roti, you know? If I leave it as roti, and most of the Germans don't know what the roti is, unfortunately, I have to make a note explaining the roti, which is very nice, so later on they will know it. But on the other hand, if they read, if it's a verse, for example, they might feel strange. They might not like it because it's not immediate. It doesn't give you an immediate sense of what it means, you know. So it's always a difficult decision, and I wouldn't be a fundamentalist about it. I would do it really. I would try to be very practical in my approach, you know. Even if you take Walter Benjamin, you know, if you read his translation of Baudelaire, you know, the Fleur du Mal, the flowers of evil, he has translated this book, volume of poetry by Baudelaire, or some of those poems, you will find that he doesn't stick to his own maxims, to his own ideas about translation, you know, because this is just a theory, and it's a theory about culture and transposition and so on, but it's a cosmopolitan theory, because it says that, first of all, we have to keep in mind that there are many differences we cannot overcome between the languages, you know? This is why he said there is some kind of ideal language which you can never reach, but which you can strive for, you know? Be it as a poet or be it as a translator. And the translation, as it touches upon something common, a commonality between all human beings, because if you translate a text, even if it's not the precise meaning, you give the other, in another language, an idea of what it could mean, you know? So you enlarge the readership and the text falls on a common human ground, you know? So you have this is kind of a common language, which is not a language in words, but a language in meanings. You know, it's, I think, something very Platonic, I think, you know, you have a realm of ideas and of general conceptions and so on. From a cosmopolitan point of view, this is very important, you know, but which is also very important because you cannot translate everything. It's impossible. And even if it's translated, you cannot read anything. So there will be, you know, for each of us, even the people most widely read, there will be much more things you will never read and you have not read than the things you have read, you know? So what to do about it? This is a funny thing, and this is why we need to be aware that non-understanding is part of human life, you know? And that we need to be tolerant with non-understanding. We cannot expect anything to be self-understanding or to be understandable for us. We must accept that there are many white spots everywhere, you know, in books, but also in reality, you know, which we can never really understand. And we have to become tolerant for it. Nowadays, there is this with the mass media and TV and politicians which promise you everything, you know, and ideologues and religious people even promising you paradise, you know. They say it's all easy, you get it anywhere, you know, and you can understand everything, you know. But this is wrong, you know. The reality is always much bigger than anything we can understand. We have to keep that in mind, you know. And this can also connect to the idea of being a stranger, because if you don't understand things, and we cannot understand anything, so we are surrounded by things we cannot understand. We try to ignore them, okay, but sometimes we are confronted with them, and we still cannot understand them, and that does not mean we now must delete them, or we must, by force, understand them. No, we must be tolerant with non-understanding, and this means also a tolerance towards our being as always, a stranger in the world. You see the connection of the concept?
Absolutely, and that is why I wanted you to... So this idea that not all difference can be eroded, that non-understanding has its own value, and yet we have empathy towards a stranger. Those we don't know, those we don't understand, whose customs and ways of living we sometimes even find problematic, we still coexist because we are all strangers and we all come with our own history. So that's the sort of message I'm getting from your work. And so that goes me to the more sort of provocative side of our little conversation, and then hopefully people. So, and please, this, I'm sure, as coming from Germany, you always hear this, but one of the things that happens in the 30s and 40s, it's not a history of Germany, it's a lesson for all of us. And what happens is the eradication of the Jewish population or others is not the eradication of the other, but it's the eradication of self. Right? So they're Germans, right? And they're Germans in some ways that are very, much more profound than people who think they're of different religions. And that whole history, and it's happening today, that this whole notion of modern notions of citizenry, that once you take away the passport, and this is the more sort of recent kind of invocation of mid-90s, early 20th century work, but the point is that the idea that then those are expendable people, right? Those who do not have a certain kind of subject position or citizenry. You take it away. First you take away their nationalism and then they can be done away with, right? And that's what you were suggesting. So that brings us to the anxieties that are there today in Europe. The way in which the other within that has now been there 50, in some cases 50, 60 years, is creating a certain kind of, some are more recent, is creating in Europe or in the quote-unquote the West, because we should also provincialize the West, as the face says, is, I mean, it's not a stereotype, but it can be anywhere. Those things, those kinds of processes are happening here, those are happening across the border, those are happening in the Middle East, they're happening in Indonesia. So it's not unique, it's a process, but I'm just saying it in terms of an example, that the kind of ways the others are creating anxiety, especially Muslim others are creating anxieties, sort of make us think about a certain moment in early 20th century as well. And so how does one then, through your kind of work, create a, you know, having known that history, the notion of the stranger, the notion of translation, now all of you realize where we were going with this, how do we then, people like yourself who work with philosophical traditions, with the Western traditions, with also the larger traditions of world knowledge, sort of think through this moment in terms of, not in real politique, but the point of how does one create a discursive space so that history may not repeat itself?
Yes. This is what we try to avoid, that history repeat itself. Yeah, that's absolutely true. But to start where you started with the 30s and 40s in Germany and Hitler and the Holocaust, it was right what you said, that of course the Jews, in fact, they were absolutely German. They were German in any sense you can think of, just they had another religion. You know, they even had the same blood. Even though, of course, Hitler told us, or tried to tell the German, that they don't have the same blood. But of course, this is, it was a joke. I mean, it was not a joke, it was a very brutal joke, but it was not true. You know, people mix up, you know, even along the borders of religions, and especially so in Germany. And you said, well, they killed a part of the self. Yes, retrospectively they did so. But in their own understanding, the Nazis, you know, they tried to find the other, to define themselves, and then they tried to purify themselves. You know, to be pure. You know, in that sense, or to be. And I think this can be connected to what I said about the strangers. You know, because if you don't accept that there are strangers, you know, and strange things, and things you don't understand, you know, you are kind of, sooner or later, you're forced to extinguish anything you cannot understand or anything which seems strange to you or what somebody tells you is strange, even if you never experience it as a strangeness, you know. This is what's happening now with a lot of ideologies, you know. Take the Syrian civil war, you know. You tell people, well, your neighbor or the in Iraq, you know, your neighbor is Christian or Yazidi or Shia.
Sixties in Indonesia.
He's a communist or whatever. Before you lived well with him, but then people tell you, well, this is a stranger, this is wrong, this is something you shouldn't accept or whatsoever. And then sooner or later you will be forced to fight with him. You know, you will be forced to extinguish him or to expel him or whatsoever. So this is very dangerous. And the danger is that now, of course, we don't have, first of all, anti-Semitism, that means the hatred of the Jews, is kind of forbidden in Germany. You cannot, of course, there are people who hate the Jews, be it openly or undercover, but in fact, nobody really dares to say it openly, you know, because of the German history. Yeah? So now, the German right-wing parties, they are looking for another stranger, another say, who is the other stranger, you know? And they are also not really allowed to practice racism, you know? Racism is a dirty word and you're not supposed to be a racist person, you know? Because you say racism is, well, this is old-fashioned stuff, we are not racist, you know? So they cannot say, well, this is a foreigner because he has a darker skin or because he speaks a funny language, because this would be racism. No,
they make up the stranger out of, and once again, a religion, and then this time it's Islam, you know? And they can do so because they say, well, we have rational reasons. It's Islam is a backward religion. Islam is a violent religion. Islam doesn't accept our values and so on. And so they create, they rationalize their hatred of the other. You know, they find a reason to be a racist or to be an anti-Semite and to create a stranger. They think they can find this reason in Islam. You know, they're serious people. I mean, serious and educated people. Somebody who was an important politician, even not from the right wings, but from the German Social Democrats. It's called Thilo Sarrazin, you know, and he was a famous banker of the Bundesbank, of the Federal Reserve Bank. And he has lately become somebody who really wages a war against Islam, you know. He wrote a book called Enemy Takeover. And the enemy, which he says is taking over Germany, it's the Muslims, it's Islam, you know. And he like reads the Quran, of course he doesn't know Arabic or anything, but he reads the Quran like literally, you know, in a very superficial manner. He says, well, this is very problematic and this doesn't fit to us. And then he says, well, every Muslim is a blind believer in the literal understanding of the Quran. You know, he thinks the Muslims are as stupid as he is when he reads the Quran in German. And so then he says, well, all those Muslims, if they live here and they believe in what the Quran says according to his understanding, then it's impossible to live with them. So we have to be defensive, we have to try to get to get rid of them, or we have to fight them in whatever way. Of course, he doesn't say we have to fight them in a violent way. This is the part of the thugs, you know, which also exist, the right-wing thugs. But he gives arguments, rationalized arguments to even the educated public, because no uneducated person reads this book. And he says this book several hundred thousand times. You know, and many people believe him, and for them this is a justification not to like Islam and not to let immigrants into Germany, even if they are political refugees or even if they are war refugees.
No, thank you. I'll ask one last question, and you can then hopefully people will add. And I'm just thinking, you know, historically, the concept of Europe, at least, you know, I mean, some people would argue, historians would argue. And it's, I mean, and I don't want to say this is sort of Islam and the West is sort of Christianity and Islam is the whole thing, but the notion of Europe actually is also sort of, you know, around 13th, 14th century, sort of the Crusades, right? And then there are also anxieties then, I mean, Carlo Ginzburg and others write about the Templars coming in and were they converted, coming back from Jerusalem and, you know, things like that. So there has been a certain, and of course the Jews within and the kind of notions various ways in which Christendom sort of feels anxious, whether it's sort of, so those histories are there, but it's not that contemporary. We're talking about very modern phenomena, because, you know, over here people can say, oh, this is a sort of a war from you know, eternity. But I think this is a modern phenomena, and the modern phenomena maybe is also, some of it may be too recent because of the movement from, you know, post-conflict in Syria and Iraq. But also when we look at Eastern Europe and the way these post-socialist societies, like whether it's Poland or Hungary or you know, other Eastern European countries, but also the rise in Western Europe where we thought of liberalism, democracy, tolerance, the history of enlightenment having taken, you know, the kind of import time in Holland or in Austria and other places. So there is a certain kind of a larger tension or anxiety or the sort of ways in which xenophobia or hatred is being, and you've answered it, but I just want to give a sense of the larger Europe and in which because now there are other ways that are happening. I mean, the vibrancy of certain democratic traditions can see that an Arab can become the mayor of Rotterdam, right? Or there are various ways in which, in United Kingdom as well, but also in Europe, various ways in which the people of Middle Eastern or South Asian descent or East Asian descent in the case of Holland are sort of rising, and people are writing books, or there is a younger generation, they say, we are German. We may be brown, we maybe have a Turkish name, but we are German authors, right? I mean, so those kinds of things are happening, or filmmakers, or artists, or what have you. So this kind of vibrancy is also coming in, where people are answering back and saying, I'm Swedish, whether I'm brown or black or white, right? So just a little bit on that, I mean, if it's of concern to you, and then we can open it up.
Yeah, in fact, the situation is very mixed, you know? It's not just bleak, you know? It's not, you have Islamophobia, yes, and it's strongly, it's very strong also in Holland, thing of Geert Wilders and Britain, the whole Brexit, and also in Germany, of course. But you also have very positive developments, you know? The for example, one of the heads of the Green Party, which is now the third largest party in Germany, is of Turkish origin, you know? And you have so you have a lot of very prominent Muslim intellectuals in Germany, and or Muslim media people, and they're getting more and more accepted. But at the same time, as they get more and more accepted, also the wave or the movement against them is building up. It's building up as a resistance towards it. So we observe that the society is getting more and more divided in a way, you know, in a very progressive way on the one hand, and a very regressive or reactionary way on the other hand. And this is, of course, a difficult development. And we just, I think this is happening in all European societies, you know. It is at stake now in Britain, of course, which is very evident with the Brexit. It's in France, you have the Yellow Vest movement, which is, of course, an anti-Macron movement. And you have it in Germany with the new party in the parliament, new right-wing party in the parliament, and with a lot of anti-Islamic or Islamophobic sentiment in the public. You have it in very visible in Eastern Europe. Even you can say that in Eastern Europe, the reactionary trend has already taken over the political scene, you know? So the development is, what's going to happen is really open, but despite the positive developments, I would say it's dangerous, and we have to be on alert, and we have to fight. We have to fight. And also, I'm an activist, but I'm also more trying to get to the roots, you know. And for me, the problem is much deeper than just between liberalism and conservatism or reactionary forces. I think the problem is inherent in the Enlightenment tradition, you know. It's what has been called the dialectics of Enlightenment, you know. Because it's if you have a nation state, you know, it can be a progressive player, but it can also be a regressive player, you know. And the idea of a nation as such is a dangerous idea, you know, because you separate people. You separate them mostly artificially. I mean, you in Pakistan, I don't need to tell you this, you know. This is, just look at your history, you know, and the idea of that the whole world has to consist of nations, you know, is an idea which can only end up in a catastrophe, and it's about to end up in a catastrophe, as has already done in many cases. So we also have to fight nationalism. That doesn't mean that we have to destroy existing nation states, no. But we have to alleviate them. We have to find things which transgress the nation state. We have to build bridges. We have to build more and more bridges so that in the end, there might be even no borders anymore, you know? And this is what we did try in Europe, in the European Union. And this is a project which is endangered now too. But this is a very backward idea of nationalism, which if you try to separate everybody into a nation state, then everybody will fight against the other, because you find always smaller units to build up a nation state. You have Spain, and then you have the Catalans, and then maybe you have a minority in the Catalans, and you will never end up, you know? So,
yeah, no, the notion that certain people live around in a certain geographical boundary is always exclusionary principle. That's sort of the underlying exclusion principle in the liberal thought as well. If you have to be like us, otherwise, and then the notion of self and other keeps on happening. And one of the things I also think before, you know, the issue is that if you go to places like Dresden or eastern part of Germany, or perhaps to Eastern Europe, and the way in which the welfare state has also pulled back, the notion that there's always the other to blame for the miseries that have not, that have still exist in places like, not in Dresden itself, it's become Disneyland, but around, you know, the kind of industrial landscape there is. So you have these pockets, and I, that you can go ahead. If all of you allow, then we can have you, sir, here yourself. So we'll start with that. One, two, three, four, five. Let's take these five first. Let's go ahead, sir.
You have a mic?
Short.
You have a mic?
Yeah, we have a mic. But we get a mic. But please keep it short. We don't want, because we don't have time, we want specific questions. Or if you have comments, then keep it short, please. Disagreements are allowed, but shortness is important. Yes, we come to you.
So the concept of the stranger is quite prevalent in Pakistan. Like we have strangers in Ahmadis, like they are not Muslim in every definitions. So the concept of strangers are there or in the Hindus, in the Christian, in the communists, like in 80s, the communists were. Now recently, ethnic minorities are strangers. So why it happened within Islam? That's
okay. So we'll stop there, we'll take a couple. Why don't you go ahead?
I have a quick question, Islamophobia. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, I had a... Islamophobia, my question is how do you define Islamophobia? I've always been quite confused by it. Because ideas don't have rights, people have rights. So is Islamophobia criticizing or critiquing certain Islamic doctrines or Islamic traditions, or is hatred, or is it anti-Muslim bigotry?
Okay. We'll take these two and then Nusrat.
Yeah, I try to answer your question first. You're absolutely right. Ideas, of course, ideas can be criticized. So the thing is, in which context do you do so? Why do you do so? What are the consequences of what you do? And how consistent are your ideas? This is how I would measure or evaluate what people do, you know. So if you take the book by Thilo Sarrazin and translate it to Pakistan and read it in a Pakistani context, it might be interesting, you know, because it contains some kind of self-critique, you know. So Islam is put in the situation of, or in the need of defending itself, you know. For example, you have to explain why Islam is violent. So Sarrazin says, Islam is violent because the Quran says so and because it has been violent all the time. You know, so then it's your task to say, well, my Islam is different. I have a different understanding of Islam because of this and this and this. So, but in Germany, he says so, and of course the minority is Muslims, and the minority has no very strong voice, you know? And this is what the Germans think anyways about Muslims. So those ideas are not contended with. They're not contradicted in an efficient way. And this is why I think, for me, the instance of Islamophobia, okay? And Sarrazin doesn't do so because he's interested in reforming Islam, or he's interested in trying to find the truth. Of course, he says this is the truth, but he does so because he is, for whatever reasons, afraid of Muslims, and he thinks, well, for me, he's racist. Fine, stop, full stop. And now this is a very good question, because in saying that even the Muslims are strangers, kun ghariban, be a stranger, this is what the Prophet says, and this is a very famous hadith. It's one of the 40 hadith of Nawawi. You can find it there. So it's a hadith everybody should know, even, yeah? Because if he tells you, be like a stranger, then you're even like those you consider as a stranger, be they Muslims or non-Muslims. You're like them. There's no difference between you and them anymore. So this is in a higher perspective. Of course, on a lower level, of course, you are a Muslim and he's a Hindu and this one is a Christian. Of course, there's a difference. But from a metaphysical perspective, from the perspective of God, there is no difference anymore. You're all strangers on this earth, you know? And this is why I like about what I like about the concept. And this is why the Prophet said so.
So, I have, my inquiry is more esoteric with the meaning of Qareeb, whether it has to do with Gnostic traditions, with the idea of concealed knowledge to which we are strangers, and that we have to seek that knowledge in order not to be Qareeb.
Yes, yes, this is a very smart smart commentary. Yes, in fact it is. I mean, of course I have only presented a very, very abbreviated version of my thinking about this issue. In the longer version, which hopefully I will publish on Academia Edu after time, of course, I think there's a strong Gnostic influence, you know, and Islam has has adopted to those influences. And the Gnostic idea is that, of course, it's the same, you know, we are strangers on this world, and there's a spark, a divine spark in us, you know, which we have to discover, and there's a special knowledge which helps us to discover this, you know. But I think the Gnostic tradition was very important in the Eastern Mediterranean, in Iraq, in Iran, from a very long time, from before Christ till after Christ. But I think, and it was persecuted. It was persecuted by the official Islam, because Islam was afraid of this, because it was strong. And so this is why they adopted, they persecuted the Gnostics, but they also adopted them or some of their ideas to make it easier for Gnostic people to become Muslims, you know? So they became Muslims, and there's a strong Gnostic, like, strand in Muslim history. If you take a famous Arabic Farsi mystic called Shihabuddin Sohrawardi, He wrote a little story called Qissat al-Ghurba al-Gharbiya. There's a story of the Western exile, you know, which is a play of words, because the West is the Gharb, and the Gharbi is the stranger. So and strangeness is in the West, you know. This is a very funny. And he was killed by Saladin, you know, in Aleppo in the 12th century. So you see that there was a struggle around this concept. But for me, the Islamic tradition is more important in the end than the Gnostic tradition, because it popularized this version. It took away the esoteric knowledge. It's not anymore an elite knowledge. For the Gnostic, knowledge is an elite knowledge, you know, it's for people who have a special, they're the chosen ones, you know. But Islam, no, Islam popularized, and it's even the poorest, it's the Darwish who take it over. So this is the interesting thing, this is why I think Islam did a good job taking this concept, you know.
And the issue of Gharib, and there's also Haramji. So there are two kind, which the foreigner, the word foreigner comes from the Arabic root, and even in Star Trek, the Ferengi, they say, you know, if you are Star Trek fans, and the Franks, but it is from there, right? The point is that when they sort of come for the Crusades, but go ahead.
Well, I have a comment and a question. The comment is that you say the stranger, well, there are different strangers, because obviously when the Europeans came to colonize Asia and Africa, they too were strangers, but they were in power. So if you are a stranger but in power, then you are treated differently. But if you are a stranger and not in power, a powerless stranger, then the treatment becomes different. That is my comment. The question is, aren't Arabs also Semites? And if you have a law which does not allow Germans to be anti-Semitic, then how is it that they can be anti-Arabs? I mean, ethnically, they're all Semites.
Yeah, I like this. You're absolutely right, of course. I mean, I wouldn't talk in terms of race or blood. I would talk in terms of language, and of course Hebrew language, Jewish language, is a Semitic language, like is Arabic language. So, and so you're absolutely right. this is the irony, you know, while trying to avoid anti-Semitism, they become anti-Muslim, but that means in the end that they go back to their roots of anti-Semitism, you know, which is very funny. But of course there is, I mean, there is no official law which forbids anti-Semitism because it's hard to define, it's hard to persecute. So, of course, practically, nobody. Of course, you're not supposed to say, if you say kill all the Jews, you might be persecuted. But this is also true for if you say kill all the Muslims. But it's more subtle, of course, subtle anti-Semitism. For the other sense, yeah, of course, you're right. But I'm interested in this concept, which, of course, is a Muslim concept. So, whatever, the Europeans, of course, they came as conquerors, as you like, you know. And, of course, they were strangers. And maybe they were treated nicely, and maybe they were treated too nicely, which made them feel invited, you know. So maybe this concept even was read or was understood as an invitation, you know. But of course I'm not talking about the practical issue of treating or dealing with strangers in Muslim countries or in other countries, which might have been the same as the treatment with strangers in many other places, but I'm interested in the philosophical concept, in the ideological concept, and in what you can do with it, and that you can overcome with it many many concepts which set up a divide between people. You know, among them nationalism, racism, and so ever. And this is a tradition which is there in Islam, but which you can also take over if you're a non-believer, because it is a metaphysical or is an existentialist understanding, you know, even if you don't believe in God, you know, that doesn't mean that you feel automatically at home, you know. And a large part of Western history is not believing anymore in God. So you lose your metaphysical home in the afterworld, and that forces you to establish a home country on earth. Whatever it costs, because you have no other chance, you know? And this invites you to take the most extreme ways to do so. You know, technically, militarily, whatever you're saying, in medicine, whatsoever, you know? You're not allowed to die anymore, you know? Because then you're lost, you know?
So I have two very quick questions. One is about the Samuel Huntington's notion of clash of civilization, and other is about the scientific advancement. We know that many nations in the world are actually going in the future so fast, and many societies in the world are actually stick to their own cultures and ideologies, and they are reluctant towards scientific advancement. How do you think that in the far future, the scientific advancement is going to be a challenge for the different nations in the world?
So I had asked Stefan that I will not ask about Huntington, but you beat me to it, so I'll let him answer.
Yeah, but I missed the link between the scientific development and being Huntington.
It's different.
Are there two different questions? Okay. The conception of Huntington, I'm not a fan of Huntington, first of all. The conception of Huntington is very seductive in a way, because it seems, from a very superficial point of view, it seems very evident, you know. And if you take what he said in the beginning of the 90s and you see what has become later, what has become until now, you think, well, wasn't he right, you know? So the question is, if we don't agree with him, for whatever reasons, we have to deconstruct his ideas. We have to find how could that come about, you know? And one reason how that could come about is that the concept of Huntington, first of all, it takes up older concepts of cultural differences and also hegemony and so on. So it took it over, and it seemed very evident to many people, and they turned it into real politics. So what happened was that that Huntington did not foretell the future, but that the politicians who made the future, who were responsible for the future, they took his ideas and turned them into a future. So it was like a self-fulfilling prophecy, you know? I just give you a very small example. There's a passage in Huntington where he says that he says he talked to many European politicians in the 80s or sometime, no, when they were deciding to take Greece into the European Union, as a part of the European Union. He was told, he says, by many European politicians that Greece is not really a part of Europe. It's not really a part of Europe. Somehow they're more Eastern, they belong more to Turkey, whatever. They are Orthodox, they are not Catholic Christian or Protestant Christian. They are, they don't really belong. This is what was told to Huntington. Huntington says, well, they told it behind, not openly, but just like this personally to me, you know? And then you see what happened with Greece in 2007-08, the financial crisis. It was nearly bankrupt, you know, and the big question was, well, what do we do with Greece, and Greece is so different, and what so on, you know? And I think that because of that, because Europe never took Greece seriously, you know? They played with it. They gave it a lot of loans, because you give loans, you get the money back later, you make a lot of gain, and then the loans, what did the Greek people, they bought stuff in Germany, for example. Germany gives money, and the Greek buy a military warship they don't need, just like this. It's good for Germany, because they buy it from Germany, you know? So Germany double profits from it. This is what England, or the Brits did with India, I think, you know, or with Egypt and so on. It's a traditional politics. So they didn't really take it as a partner, but somebody to play with, you know? And so this is how it came about that Greece came be indebted and nearly a bankruptcy and so on. Now we have all these problems. But these problems are a problem of conception also, you know, because you conceive Greece as something, well, they're not really, a bit backward, you know. You can treat them as you like, you know. And then something like that happens, you know. And also the divide is along the conception of a religion, because for Huntington the border is a religious border. It's a border between Western Christianity and Eastern Christianity, like Orthodox Christianity, you know. And the Europe had a very strange conception of Greece as being the Athens, you know, the ancient Greece. Of course, the Greece of nowadays, they don't know anything about Athens anymore, and they don't need to, you know, because their conception of being Greek is a Christian Orthodox conception. And until the 30s of the 20th century, the capital of the Greek people, it was supposed to be Constantinople or Istanbul, it was not Athens. Because in Constantinople, this was Eastern Rome, you know, this was their nation, their self-understanding of themselves. Europe has all the time mistaken them. Europe had a fantasy of Athens, of ancient Greece, you know? And they tried to turn the real Greek people, which were Orthodox and oriented towards Istanbul, into ancient Greeks living in Athens, you know? And of course, this is a very funny concept. it kind of worked out, you know, but it made many people unhappy, I think, apart from the exchange of population between Turkey and Istanbul, another kind of separation, like you lived here in Pakistan, and all this dirty nationalist stuff, you know?
Well, I've been told that...
Oh, the technics, I don't know about technics. I'm not a tech... I just know how to use my iPhone, and I'm happy that I can do so.
Well, we could take...
Sorry.
You could have an exchange later on. I'm sorry, I've been told the time is up. But Professor Weidner is here, and if you want to meet him, thank you very much for coming out and hearing such wonderful, you know.
Thank you, Kamran. You're wonderful too. Yes, yes.
All right.
Thank you. Thank you.